Today, experts and insiders will help us discuss what goes on behind the scenes of Filipino art or a Filipino artist getting international attention, whether it's critical acclaim or auction success. This is in anticipation of the Asian Cultural Council 2022 happening this March the 5th. And as you know, the ACC has been sending the most deserving artists and creatives to various esteemed residencies abroad to enrich not only their personal art making, but also perhaps indirectly introduce new ideas and skills to the local art community. What does it take for Filipino art to break into the international art world? How did Juan Luna do it? How did Ronald Ventura find himself within the radar of big moneyed Asian collectors, which eventually led to his auction star stature? Well, to start things off, I'd like to introduce to you an ANCX Forum regular. We'll set the tone for the rest of our discussion by taking us back to a famous toast done by Juan Jose Rizal, our national hero, sometime in 1884, in honor of two extraordinarily talented Filipino artists. Friends, please welcome lawyer, collector, and art world insider, Attorney Tonico Manahan. Hi, Tonico.
Hi, Seth. How are you?
Good. I hope you're well.
Yes, I'm very well. In June 1884, it was on the cusp of the victory of both Luna and Hidalgo in a competition. And this was shocking to the rest of the world that Filipinos, or in some way, second-class Spaniards, as far as they were looked at, whatever, were capable of such creative genius. And Rizal made a famous brindis, or toast, towards the two in a dinner. And it became a focal point of the reform movement in the sense that showing that Filipinos are creative and we're not monkeys. No? I'll read you a very small portion of the toast that will set the tone for the whole day and what is world class. He said, "Luna and Hidalgo are the pride of Spain, as of the Philippines. Though born in Philippines, they might have been born in Spain, for genius has no country. Genius bursts forth everywhere. Genius is like light and air, the patrimony of all, cosmopolitan as space, as life and God." So this is 137 years ago. And we have yet to, you know, all of us loving Philippine art, know that Philippine art can be or is world class. But for the rest of the world to recognize that, we have not experienced this moment since then.
Okay, thank you, Tonico. That's a beautiful way to set the tone for this afternoon's discussion. To give insights on the career Juan Luna forged in Europe, we have filmmaker, writer, and now producing a documentary on Juan Luna. We're so fortunate to have him. He can only stay for 30 minutes because he's catching a flight. Hi, Martin Arnaldo is here joining us from Paris. Hi, how are you?
Hi, Seth. Thank you so much for inviting me to this session. I'm very honored to be part of this because my father used to work for ABS-CBN. So it's a very big honor for me to be here.
First of all, how did Luna gain considerable success and acclaim as an artist in Europe?
Well, first of all, Juan Luna was a genius. That's what has been written. I'm not inventing this because he's our artist. He's always been considered a genius from a very young age, especially when he arrived in Rome. People would actually go to his studio in 1882 with the Benjures. The studio was a kind of theater, where you would have models, artists, painters, musicians, and they would be playing music, they would be doing all these kinds of things. And Luna would actually be painting while all this was happening. And sometimes he would take a few steps back and jump on a table to look at his spoliarium. And then he would jump back and then finish the coat of paint. And there are a lot of people in Spain who have written about this. So unfortunately, it's not really... it hasn't trickled down to our culture. We don't know the people who have... he's appeared in several, even in several books and all that, that we're not aware of. But at that time, he was already considered a genius, and this is in 1882, just the moment when Pradilla had won the Medal of Honor with the Rendición de Granada. And this is the moment where Luna is going to start working on his spoliarium. And of course, the spoliarium is going to become the his big first claim to fame that attorney Manahan was mentioning a while ago with the letter, with the Brindis of Rizal. Mm-hmm. So I guess it was really from Rome that it started.
His being Filipino, being, you know, from a colony of Spain did not matter to those who were amazed at his genius.
Actually, that's very interesting that you're saying that, because at the end of the 19th century, there were a lot of theories of race. For example, you have the feminist Emilia Pardo Bazán, who's a feminist, who described Luna as having a Mogolic type, right? Was nevertheless for her a genius. So even the Mogol, even the other, the person you would not qualify as part of the white race, was considered a genius. But that was in Spain. When Luna arrived in France, it was a different story because the French are were more racially divisive than the Spaniards. Mm-hmm. But yes, that went against him in many ways. Mm-hmm. You would have, for example, Maupassant, the writer from France, who would claim that spoliarum was a savage work, mm-hmm. right? So it always worked against him. We could never remove the quality of his race in his work, although his work always lived beyond the restraints of his race. Mm-hmm. And hopefully it will go back to France and Spain, and we already have one work back in the Prado. So hopefully all the works will get known.
But was he able to circulate among, you know, collectors, museum personalities, personages from the art world, cultured people, I mean, those who were influential in society?
Totally. In Madrid, he was very well known. You would read Rizal saying how famous Luna was in Madrid. And he was always invited left and right, always attending the inn cafes and restaurants. In France, he would always be invited by people from the nobility, especially like after his trial, he was invited somewhere, and he would circulate in those circles. But I think what got him to a position of notoriety in Madrid, especially, was his special relationship with the King of Spain. So that really brought about a big change in Luna's life.
What about his style? Was he painting like everyone else in Europe at that time? What was distinctive about his work?
Luna was part of what we can call a modern. So modern is a very intangible definition, because modern just means breaking away, breaking off with the past. Mm-hmm. So there's every period has its modern element. And in the late 19th century, Luna was a modern, so he was not always recognized. For example, he was not an academic. He always hated academic standards. That's what got him away from Manila. That's what got him away from the Real Academia de Bellas Artes in Madrid. And that's why he left with Alejo Vera. And that's also what got him close to Mariano Benlliure, his very close friend in Rome, because Mariano never took a class, never had a teacher, and had an immense freedom that Luna always admired. So Luna always tried to be free and to break away with the past. So for example, the Battle of Lepanto, which is a historical painting that hangs in the Senate, was supposed to be academic. And the senators, like Madrazo, who was part of the senators for the art part, did not like the Battle of Lepanto because it was not academic. The colors were different. The perspective was bold. So in that sense, it could be called modern. He was beyond his time.
Tell us about how he got to befriend the King of Spain. I mean, how did that happen?
Well, in 1884, we're going back to 1884, Spoliarium. People were always were wondering why he did not get the Medal of Honor, as Predilla did in 1878, because both works had extremely good reviews in the press, and everybody was like saying good things about it. So there was a feeling of injustice about that, and apparently, according to Jack Pilar, and the king gave an audience to Luna and the Benyuri brothers, and because he felt that there was an imbalance, that Luna did not get the Medal of Honor because he was an Indio, the king decided to talk to the Senate, and the Senate commissioned the Battle of Lepanto to hang opposite the Pradillas Rendición de Granada. And by hanging opposite to a Medal of Honor, it would show that Luna was equal to someone who won a Medal of Honor. The biggest prize that had not been given since 1858. So, I mean, Pradilla was in 1878, but before that, it hadn't ever been given. So it was a great, great honor. And that's how the king influenced Luna. Now, how did Luna get to know the king? Luna got close to the king through the Benyuri brothers.
Mm-hmm. And so he would frequently be invited to wine and
not wine? Really, not really. There's a claim that he visited Luna in Rome, the Marguta studio in Rome, but it's impossible to verify this. But we know that the king was extremely close to Mariano Benyuri, because at age 13, Mariano saw the entrance of the king in Madrid in 1875 with the Bourbon Restoration. And he sculpted an equestrian statue that was displayed at the Plateria de Martinez. And the king saw it and gave 500 pesetas to Mariano Benyuri. And he was only age 13. And from then on, the king always stayed very close to Mariano Benyuri. There was this special relationship that is in no official documents. So it's very difficult to ascertain what was the exact relationship of Juan Luna and the king.
Let's talk about the Benyuri brothers.
The Benyuri brothers were artists that came from a very humble family in Valencia. And they met Luna in the Circle of International Students in Rome in 1881. That's when Mariano arrived in Rome in 1881. And they became very close. Mariano became a very important sculptor because he sculpted the whole, the King Alfonso XII and the Retiro, that whole monument to Alfonso XII is Mariano Benyuri. He became one of the greatest artists of sculptures of Spain. So that's the one on the right side, Mariano on the top right, yeah.
Yes. Well, what influence did the brothers have on him?
I think the biggest influence they had on Luna was his liberty. So Mariano Benyuri, again, never took any course with any teacher. And you must remember that in 1881, when they met, Juan Luna just came from Madrid a few years ago, where he was studying under Federico de Marrazo at the Academia de Bellas Artes de San Fernando. So, and Luna did well under Marrazo. He almost got a medal, but he was in the A student list, but he quit and he left with Alejo Vera, and he met this Mariano in Rome. And Mariano taught him this sense of freedom. Maybe it became like a kind of bohemian style of freedom, because they would travel to Rome when he was when they were young, the Benyuris, almost like bohemians. And if you look at the pictures of Juan Luna, they're always dressed up in this bohemian fashion. So that's something that he gave to Luna. It's, I guess, a sense of freedom. And aside from the King of Spain, I don't really see the others, maybe the mayor of Madrid, Abascal, or one of the senators, Silvela, that were who probably helped Juan Luna from then, thanks to Mariano.
So they were like, he introduced some of his patrons, perhaps, to Luna as well.
Yes, and he defended them. I mean, he's the one who got Antonio Luna out of jail. It was Mariano Benyure who talked to the Queen of Spain, the Queen Regent. So it was through his efforts that even Antonio Luna was taken out from the prison.
How about the relationship with Pedro Paterno?
Pedro Paterno was a very influential Filipino in Madrid because he owned a lot of artworks and artifacts from the Philippines. Actually, while Hidalgo and Luna were in Rome, they used as their address for the Exposición Nacional of 1884, where Spoliarium won, the address of Pedro Paterno. So he was like he was really taking care of them. He was really helping them out. Very, very.
When their money would run out, I suppose they would run to him for.
I don't know. There's no. They don't talk about
that. There are no accounts about that.
No, because in 1884, I think Luna won a lot of money with Spoliarium. Luna started to have financial difficulties much later when he shifted from the academic schools to more personal works. He stopped the commissions and stuff like that. So he was earning less after, I would say, 1889. And that's when he started needing more money.
Of course, all of us are fascinated about, his love life, lack of a better word, too. His liaisons. Can you share some of his or an insight into his relationships?
Well, we all know that it ended very badly. Right. So Luna I don't know how he got into this relationship with Paz, but I know that he met her from the early days in Paris, according to to the testimonials. He probably saw her before because the school in which he was painting in 1876 or something in Manila was part of the Pardo de Tavera residence. So he perhaps saw her walk around or something like that. She was a muse for him. She was quite an important muse. We all know that it ended really terribly. So that's what's difficult about Juan Luna's life. Is how terribly this ended with Paz Pardo de Tavera.
He was not as lucky in love as he was with, achieving recognition for his art.
I guess not.
What brings you to do a documentary on Juan Luna? Tell us about your journey. Why do this? It must be so exciting.
Well, I was given a script by Butch Perez a few years ago. I told Butch a feature film, not a documentary, that I needed to research Juan Luna to know more about it. And I started researching in France and the archives and all that. And then this became an obsession because I realized that a lot of the information we have on Juan Luna is false. It has been fabricated and has been changed throughout the years to serve one family over another, or to serve some purpose of selling an artwork or something like that. So the story has changed a lot, and fortunately there's the French archives that exist, and you can go through the French archives and really find out the real story of Juan Luna, which I was trying to put together, and it took several years. And then came the biggest problem of them all, which is in today's world, you cannot have a hero that kills his wife and gets away with it, because that's the story. Juan Luna killed Paz Pablo de Tavera and got away with it. And who can write a story about a killer, a woman killer, that is pardoned, that is acquitted by the courts of France? It's very, very difficult to justify. So from then, I started to put the project not on hold, but because I have an idea to tie it again through another way. But I decided to write down and put on paper or on film all the research that I had done to bring about this film project.
And where in the project are you? About how many percent?
Well, I'm still far, because it's actually several hours, so it's in several parts. So it's
done.
Yeah, it's at least four times. It's at least four episodes. Yeah.
Wonderful. And when can we get to see it?
Oh, I cannot promise anything for the time moment, but it's ongoing. Yeah.
So this is an endeavor that took, what, how many years?
Well, the research took about 4 or 5 years, yeah. And it never ends. It keeps on, because someday, you'll start talking to the descendants of so-and-so, and you'll get new information, and history keeps adapting, evolving to all this new information that we're only starting the story of Juan Luna. It's only now that we're starting to have enough information to know who this person really was, and if he was really a hero for the Philippines or not.
He would be considered probably the first Filipino international superstar. Would you agree?
Totally, totally.
What's the most fascinating aspect of Luna, the international superstar that you discovered?
Perhaps the Battle of Lepanto, you know, but it's not superstar in the sense that they had prevented the Battle of Lepanto from going to the Exposition Universelle of Paris in 1889. But it was one of his greatest works that a lot of even contemporary critics agree. And a few of those critics at the time detested, for personal reasons, because they wanted to push forth other people. I mean, to go back very quickly, when I told you the King of Spain talked to the Senate to put the Battle of Lepanto opposite to the Clodia's Rendición de Granada, there were two more works in that room. There were four works in total supposed to complement Clodia's Rendición de Granada. And of course, they were all fighting, and they tried to kick Luna out of it, and they achieved that. They kicked him out. So Juan Luna's Battle of Lepanto is no longer in the Salon de Conferencias, but you know, it's been taken down. So I would guess that work is probably the most important work to be revealed, because it still has a becoming.
Give us an idea of how famous he was. I mean, if you were to compare to today's standards, who's an Filipino international superstar?
I don't know, but it's such a very different time, because at that time, you know, there were no interviews. The only interviews would be from police blotters. So you never, the question of fame and the image of fame was completely different to today's social media world.
Hyper social media world. But you did say the studio would, you know, people would congregate, and it was like a show, as you had said.
Exactly. But imagine, you know, like Today we're reading it like that, but maybe at the time it was like going to a party in a Sikia apartment. And so, you know, it's that little small event became so
people
big.
From all walks of life, you know, politics, fashion,
exactly,
arts.
Yeah, and maybe even the King of Spain.
Amazing. Amazing. Thank you so much, Martin, for taking time out to join us. We can't wait. We wish you all the best on your Luna documentary.
Thank you so much.